In the beginning, there's an audience waiting for a sound, and then they think, I know what I'm doing, but this is completely not true. I know less now than ever about what I'm doing. And I only recently started to allow my hands to play because they know how to begin better than I do. So they start to produce a sound that I have no control at all over. So I'm much more like the audience at that moment. It's the least manipulative moment in a concert. I don't think that people recognize what's happening sometimes as an audience member, but if they knew that that we were all being surprised at the same time, including me, by the sounds and having to adapt to them, then beginnings would be even more interesting. If the beginning connects correctly, the audience and the music connects too. If there's nothing special about it, then people get nervous, they don't know what to do, they don't know what I'm doing. I don't go and play in another country without being aware of where I am, and the music always comes out differently. The audience ends up being the commissioning body. They commission a work, and that work is for themselves. It's a private thing. Once I walk out on stage, supposedly everybody's there. The doors close. And this is a very private event. And it's only taking place in that space. The privilege of having recordings is that other people can know what happened in the space. But I disagree with anybody who says that they can give you exactly what happened in the space. It's always bigger live. Home concert, we had the wrong piano rented. We tried to get the right piano, but they didn't have the truck anymore, and the truck wasn't big enough to carry the other piano. So I had a Bösendorfer that I really didn't like, and I'm going to put these on because the lights are bothering me. I had not slept for 2 days. I had bad Italian food in a restaurant. And we went to probably tell the engineers that they could leave because it was just everything was wrong, except they sold it out. We thought we should send the engineers home, and then at the last minute, no, it's okay, we'll just keep, we'll leave, they're here already, they're set up, and we'll just have a recording for ourselves. You always want to make it as good as it can be, but when you have problems that you can't do anything about one after another, you start forgetting actually what you're doing till it's time. And that's one of the secrets to improvising. Bad enough to be a world-class musician, but to be a solo improviser doing a concert from zero, it's like building a car and not testing it each time. Again, I would not recommend any pianist to do this. And people ask, why isn't anybody else doing it? And I have to just smile. I mean, it's I'm happy for them if they're not going to try this. If you want to be born again all the time, it's very exhausting. It's dangerous because when you fail, you feel like you have failed as a living being. But he also influenced me because his way of handling his band was so minimal that nobody knew what he wanted, but he got it. The first time I ever played with Miles, and Miles brought me this little slip of paper and said, this is what he wanted me to play.
And would you play that, Keith? Play this.
So it was like two or three notes in strange places on the paper. So I played something. He said,
no, no.
And he sat at the piano and he went, you know, some kind of thing. He didn't mean what he was doing, but it was like, that was it. That was like, now it doesn't matter what you play. We had a drummer, I won't mention his name, and Miles wanted him to play this very slow beat, like the kind of slow that very slow blues is, and there's very few drummers can actually do that very well. So he kept putting fills in between the beats, and Miles kept stopping. He's like,
no, man, let's do it again. None of that shit.
So it kept failing, and Miles finally stopped and said,
okay.
And he called the guy by name, said,
all right, here's the beat, here's the tempo. Okay.
there has been no time when anybody's been anything but extremely comfortable and happy in this band. I've never seen anything like it. There was never an idea that we had a reason to stop playing together. And we just look forward so much to getting together that it's musically and personally, it's like a better than a family. I've never seen, as I said, I've never seen anything like it. We've entered each other's heads, and it hasn't messed with us. For that to go on for 25 years, and the only thing that will stop it would be physical impairment. The trio is the ultimate apolitical jazz weapon. My group has whatever the politics are when we're not playing, they're gone when we're playing. So there's no statement. There's no statement. It's got to be either eat this food or forget it. You don't need to eat it. Someone will eat this. I think that's what makes me happy. It's so simple and hard at the same time. The survival alone is something, it was like the goal. The goal was survival. In terms of being myself, not being somebody else, and not being what the audience decided I was, not being what any producer or any person other than myself knew me to be. Yes, I'm a happy man, and that's the job description. I mean, that's what jazz asks.